Good morning, church. Welcome to Valonia United Methodist Church. We are a church dedicated to loving our community as we are through words, actions, and presence. I am Pastor Chad Hornsby, and we welcome you to worship this morning as you are, as you were, and as you will be. We have a couple of announcements this morning. First, Andrea wanted me to let y'all know that the youth will be selling Valentine's dinner tickets starting next week. If you bought one of the youth shares that was the $240 one, then you can you already got your tickets, so don't worry about that. Also, we will be doing the unhanging of the greens after church today, so if you want to stay after Sunday school and take part in getting the greens taken down, that would be really helpful. Also, the Confirmands are back. They had their retreat this past weekend, and that was a really good time. I'm so glad I got to go with them, which means that next week is going to be Confirmation Sunday, and so we hope that you'll be here to support this new group of kids. We have 8 in total that went on the retreat, so it's going to be a pretty big group coming through that want to join the church. And so after that, we'll have a little reception for them. Also, there will be a charge conference after the reception for them next Sunday. Let us now turn to God in prayer as we start our worship. Wondrous God, we praise and bless you for the gift of your only begotten Son, the true light who enlightens everyone that has come into the world. May all who receive him and believe in his name be born anew as your beloved children of your redeeming purpose. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Kings. And that's number 254. We'll do all five verses. Children would come forward. We have a special message for you this morning.
Good morning. Did you guys have a really good first week of the year? Did you do anything special? Well, before we get started, I found a picture that I had, and I want to show it to you. We talk about baby Jesus being born in a manger. And do you know what a manger is? It's kind of in the stable where they feed the animals, right? Right? Well, I have a picture of a manger, a real manger. Okay? Okay, you see that? Does that look like a manger to you? Does this look like a manger? It's kind of a hard place to lay when you're a baby, isn't it? So I imagine they put straw and stuff in there to make it comfortable. But that's what a manger looks like. So now we're talking about the three wise men that went to visit Jesus. This is called the Epiphany yesterday, when that's 25 days after Jesus was born. And we'll have a little story, and we're going to have some questions, because I don't know some of these answers, okay? Do you think the wise men got discouraged on their journey to find Jesus? That was a long way. Yes? Yeah? I imagine so, because they only had the star to guide them, and they didn't know where they were going. So it could have been 10 minutes or 10 miles, couldn't it? Yeah. So they really had to keep to it to get going. They journeyed a long time and didn't know exactly where they were going until they got there. They stayed faithful to their mission even when King Herod tried to trick them. Now, why do you suppose King Herod tried to trick them? Yeah? He what? Well, yeah, and he was afraid that Jesus would take over his place as king, and he didn't want anybody to have his place. So he told the wise men, well, when you go see baby Jesus, you come back and tell me where he's at. Didn't they? Did they go back? No, they didn't. They went home another way. There was a dream that came to them that told them that Herod was going to hurt the baby. So they went back another way, and they didn't go see King Herod. Finally, well, one thing I saw in my book here is most people think that there were three wise men because there were three gifts given to Jesus. But the Bible doesn't say exactly how many wise men there were. The holiday Epiphany comes 12 days after Christmas. It celebrates the wise man's visit to see Jesus. That's good to know, isn't it? Okay, bow your heads and we'll say a prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us the baby Jesus and keep us faithful to him. Amen.
If you'll please stand and join me in singing All Is Well. The words are going to be on the screen.
Rejoice. peace on earth. Christ has come, all and tell that he is in the manger. Sing alle, sing alleluia.
All is well.
Morning. Please join me in the congregational prayer, which is printed in your bulletin and on the screen. Loving God, before time and space, your living word was with you, creating all things. In the fullness of time, he came to bring peace and to show us how to love. By the anointing of your Holy Spirit, inspire us to share his light wherever we go, as we carry your good news of salvation to the ends of the earth. Amen. First scripture reading today comes from the book of Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access in boldness and confidence through faith in him. May the Lord add God's blessing to the reading and hearing of the scripture. Thanks be to God.
This week, we're looking at the story of Epiphany. The story where magi, from a place we don't really know, come to acknowledge that the Messiah has been born. Now, I want to admit up front that when I was writing this sermon, I think I let tradition guide some of my thoughts a little bit more than the scripture, because I did, in fact, write down there are three wise men multiple times, and as Miss Karen just pointed out, that is not in our scripture. It's one of those moments where we've kind of noticed the three is that number we relate to moments that happen with Jesus, and so we use that in our tradition. However, that's not quite always the case. So thank you, Miss Karen, for catching my slip up before I started preaching. But I'm going to let us go ahead and go with it. because it made a really pretty analogy. In our story today, we look at the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew writes particularly to the Jewish population. And so when Matthew writes, he does a lot of callbacks to the Old Testament. So anytime Matthew is trying to prove why something's important or explain why something has happened, usually it'll be like, quick story, and here's the explanation from the Old Testament. Which is a really neat way to do things, I think. I think we have to be careful with it a little bit, because sometimes we use that to say, well, Judaism is invalid because we have this proof in Matthew, but I don't think that's what Matthew is trying to do. I think Matthew is trying to show that what he believes in is not something that they pulled out of thin air, but it's something with a little bit of history to it. So our second scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2, starting in verse 1. Please rise in body or in spirit for the reading of the gospel. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born king of the Jews? For we observed his star in the east, and we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all of Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes and the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophets. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the Magi, learned from them the exact time which the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may go and pay him homage." When they heard the king, they set out there, and ahead of them went the star that they had seen in the east, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left their own country by another road. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So in this story, here's the pretty analogy. There are three magi, two kings, one star. So we have three magi, or however many magi. And these are some like strange people that scholars don't really know who they are. The Greek says that they're astrologers, and tradition doesn't really have a firm grasp on them. In fact, I think one of the best explanations of who the Magi are comes in the song "We Three Kings." That is like the thing that explains it. If you notice in the scripture, it doesn't tell us why they gave a baby gold, frankincense, and myrrh, which I think continues our Christmas tradition of giving new parents strange things. But in our song, "We Three Kings," this weekend, I was thinking about it, and it says, here is something that represents the crown because you are the king. Here is something to represent worship because you are also a rabbi. And here is something to represent death and kind of that foreshadowing of what's to come. Even in Christmas, we're pointing towards Easter. But the Magi are also really interesting because they're not Jewish. There's no reason for them to be here. Why does the Bible decide to include this little story about a group of mysterious people coming from another land to pay homage to Jesus? I think one of the things that when I read it today, I realize that this is a really good analogy and model for interfaith cooperation. So you might know that back when I was in college, I worked with my wife Miranda, who started the Interfaith Initiative at Hendrix, to kind of work on having times where people of different faiths could come together and kind of talk about our holidays, usually is what it was, which I think ultimately became an excuse for us to eat food from around the world and kind of celebrate together, especially for the people who their faith community is really small in Arkansas. So, you know, I've celebrated a ton of Passovers and Eids at this point with my Jewish and Muslim friends because they wanted to celebrate this holiday in the way they celebrate at home. And when I read the story of the Magi, I realize that there's something here about God showing us and the gospel showing us how to recognize God in places that aren't just our faith. So when I was in college, one of my best friends' name was Holden. Holden is a Reformed Jew, and he became more devout as we went through college together. One of the things that I got to do was I had to interview one of my friends who was a different faith than me to find out what faith meant to them. So me and Holden are talking, and you know, I think we ended up talking for three times as long as the assignment told me I had to. But that's because he started telling me what it meant to him to be Jewish. And he said, in sum, I think I could shore all this up by saying the Jewish concept of tikkun olam is the reason why I'm Jewish. I said, well, I don't know Hebrew, so what does that mean? And he said, well, it's a phrase that means the healing of the world. You see, in Judaism, it's this concept that the world is kind of this fractured pot, and part of their purpose is to work towards mending that pot, to sealing over the cracks, to making the world whole again. And I said, that's beautiful. And even though Holden and I have different faiths, I was able to see how God was working through him. I think this is one of the things that we're still learning to do as Christians. You know, we don't necessarily always think, well, there's God in other religions too, but the gospel shows us that God is working in there and that there is an element of the divine that is going through all of our expressions of faith. I think the wise men are a great example to us, and I think it's great that Matthew has the first person to come to see Jesus be someone who's not even Jewish. It's someone you don't expect. This is a common theme in the gospel. It's the unexpected person that shows up and does the right thing. It's never the person you expect. The next thing we have in the scripture is two kings. And if any of you have watched Game of Thrones, you know that two kings at one time is usually a bad situation. There's going to be conflict. Now, King Herod is a famous king in the story of Jesus. And one of the things he was really good at is he was a really good engineer. If you ever get a chance to go to the Holy Land, the place is dotted with castles that Herod built. There are fortresses that Herod built that are still standing to this day. That's pretty impressive considering he lived 2,000 years ago, and he built a sandstone castle on the edge of the sea, and most of it's still there. That is kind of amazing. But also there's some things Herod does in our gospel that are kind of questionable. So when the Magi come into Jerusalem and they're like, hey, by the way, we think the Messiah for you has been born, what does Herod do? Well, Herod calls together all the scribes, the legal experts, the people who know scripture well enough that they can tell him exactly where the baby's supposed to be born, what's supposed to happen, what it's supposed to look like. And he gets the report, and what you would expect the king that is looking for the Messiah to do is to send those scribes right out to Bethlehem to find this child. Instead, Herod takes these strangers from a strange land that no one will miss if they go missing and sends them instead and says, by the way, come back and tell me about this when you find out. Now, I'm reading a little bit into the scripture here. It doesn't say what Herod is thinking, but I do think the fact that the wise men get a dream that says stay away from Herod is a pretty good indicator of what Herod was about to do. And even if you keep reading and read the next part of the chapter, what does Herod do? Well, Herod orders the soldiers out to go and slaughter any child under the age of 2, just to be sure. This is the story of what an earthly king becomes like. It's in stark opposition to the kind of king that Jesus comes to be. Jesus comes to be a king about peace and love and hope and joy, and is born into a world where the king is trying to kill him before he even has a chance. This is honestly not a shocking turn of events for the story. What's shocking is that, again, we have strangers being the ones who are willing to recognize what's happening. Okay, so we have 3 magi, or however many magi, 2 kings, and now 1 star. So the magi are following after this star. I don't know much about astrology, and so I don't quite know how this works, but it's kind of impressive that they're able to figure out that there is this bigger star and they start following it. Scholars don't really know what they were following. There has been speculation of, like, it could have been Halley's Comet. It could have been, like, 2 planets lined up just right to glow really brightly. But we don't really know what they're following. We know that there's some kind of mystery involved in the star. And strangely, in this star, because it's the only thing that's not a human that's important, it is the most important. But not because of the star itself, but because of what it points to. I think just as the Magi are willing to look for God outside of what they believe and what is in the normal for them, and Herod is unwilling to look for God in the place that he should be expecting it, I think the star reminds us that we need to be looking for God in the places that we both expect and don't expect. And when God shows up in a place that we don't expect, we shouldn't be concerned about that. And when God shows up in a place that challenges who we are and the way we live in the world, we shouldn't turn away from that. We shouldn't try to put that down. We should try to embrace that. You see, the story of the gospel and the story of Christmas is one that reminds us that God didn't take the easy way. When we were at the confirmation retreat yesterday, we were talking about Epiphany and kind of explaining to the confirmands what Epiphany was. One of the things that got brought up was, you know, God could have taken the easy way to live amongst us. In fact, it would have been much safer and a lot less babies would have gotten slaughtered if God would have been Herod's son instead of the carpenter's son. It would have been a lot simpler for God to live in the world if God would have chosen a better life. But instead, what God chose to do was something I think is a lot more miraculous, in that God chose to live amongst us and get the experience of the view from the bottom. One thing I don't think we talk about enough, and you know, next week will be a baptism of our Lord Sunday, and so we're going to skip over a good 30 years of Jesus' life. I guess the gospel writers didn't think it was as important to talk about how many chairs and tables Jesus built as he was a day laborer. But if you look at the scholarship, people believe that Jesus worked as a carpenter in Bethlehem and Jerusalem for 30 years before. That's a lot of time that Jesus spent just living as one of us. That's one of the things I think we skip over, and when we talk about Jesus, is that when Jesus gets to the point that he starts his ministry, he knows what it's like to be one of us. He doesn't come out the gate and just start, but he recognizes that he has a little bit of learning about what it's like to be one of us. I'm really glad that our gospel story is one where God chose to live as one of us for so long. I think that shows the kind of empathy that God has. I think it shows the kind of love that God has. And it makes the 4 years of Jesus' ministry a lot more impactful. This is our last Sunday of the Christmas season. Starting next week, we are living in the time of Christ. We're working our way towards Lent. But let us not lose sight of the fact that something miraculous has happened, that we are trying to live into this God with us still. As we go forward from today, I want us to continue to look for where God is in the places we expect, the places we don't expect, and try to keep our minds clear so that we can hear the word of God amongst us. May it be so. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith that is as it is written in the Old and New Testaments. Please stand if you're able and join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
At this time, we come together to share our joys and concerns, the things that are on our hearts. We want to lift up concerns for the Poland family as they grieve the loss of Shane's grandfather. We also want to lift up concern for Becky Gilbert and Alan Bryant, Donna Lewis's siblings, who are having procedures this week. We want to also lift up Ms. Jean Cure, who is still having some pains from shingles and needs some relief, and also Mary Rigby as she recovers from surgery. We also want to lift up the joys amongst us, one for a successful confirmation retreat this weekend, as well as Sarah French's parents and grandparents are here today, and also to all of those who helped put out the new mulch on the playground this past week. At this time, I invite us into a moment of silent prayer. You may pray in your seats, or you're welcome to go to the altar and kneel if you would like, but let's take just a few moments to pray for the other joys and concerns on our heart. Holy God, how good it is to be in your presence once again. We give you thanks for the many blessings which we have received this weekend. Keep us and help us to be your people in the world. Everlasting God, the radiance of faithful souls, you brought the nations to your light and kings to the brightness of your rising. Fill the world with your glory and show yourself to all nations. Through him who is the true light and the bright and morning star. Even Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. O Majesty on high, whom angels worship in thanksgiving for your Son, bless these gifts which we will offer, that they may bring light to the darkened corners of the world. As we pray, as Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is kingdom, and power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, if our ushers would come forward to receive our offering, if you would like to give, you can do so by placing something in the offering plate, by check to our P.O. box, or online through our website and PayPal. Thank you for supporting the ministries of this church.
Please stand for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God, the source of all.
So if you have a tween in your house, you might have heard that at the confirmation retreat, we had communion. Now, one of the things that is new to me is preparing for retreats and leaving, and so I forgot communion bread. And so we had communion with the leftover cookies from lunch, which I want to say feels a little silly, and is a strange combination with grape juice. However, it reminds us that what is happening at the table isn't about the elements. In fact, this table is a lot of not what we're doing, but what God has already done. And so that is why, as United Methodists, we believe that this table is an open table. This table doesn't belong to the United Methodist Church. It doesn't belong to Valonia United Methodist Church. This table belongs to God. God has prepared this meal for us so that we may come and taste grace. And so, if you'll follow along with the screen, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth and you had formed the earth from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity and made covenant to be our sovereign God. And you spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we join in their unending hymn and praise your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. You sent a star to guide wise men to where the Christ was born. And in your signs and witnesses in every age and through all the world, you have led your people from far places to his light. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and made covenant with us by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. All of you. This is my body, which has been broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciple, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the new covenant poured out for you. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's sacrifice for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. At this time, if the communion stewards would come up to help serve. If you need gluten-free, you can come to the center aisle here and receive that. We will have three sections on either aisle. Come, the table is ready.
you're not sure who you really are. When all you feel is the shape of your scars, and you have more wounds than you can count, open your eyes.
Please stand and join us in singing. We're going to sing Noel. The words are going to be on the screen.
Incarnate love divine, a star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. No
Before we leave, I wanted to make note that Megan Johnson was passing around the sign up for the Super Supper. So if you would like to sign up for that before you leave, that would be very helpful. But receive this benediction. Let us be inspired by the journey of the Magi. Let us remember that we too have much to find about God. In recognition of this time that is coming to an end, we celebrate the time that is to come. Let us remember that we do not leave the church. We go out to be the church. May the hope of the newborn Christ, the nurturance of God Almighty, and the playfulness of the Holy Spirit be with us always. Amen.
God.